Feedback from Warsaw University. I have a question about collaborations. You mentioned about collaboration, because some part of the project can be done in collaboration, but is it really an advantage or disadvantage for the ERC grant?
So I would say it depends, you know, if it will be the more than the half of the project done by collaborators, of course it's a disadvantage. But if the 10% will be done by collaborator which have experience, which from your CV is obvious you don't have, I think it's fine, no?
Yes, so collaboration does not mean shared grant. So it's not a co-application. It's not about two people coming together to apply for a grant. If you are lacking a certain type of expertise and somebody else has it, then you can have that this person will provide some input and will perhaps do part of the work, but it should not be a major component of the proposal. For that, if you need really synergistic aspects of the proposal, we have the synergy scheme, which is exactly that, two to four people actually coming together and addressing a big question when no one by himself or herself can do that.
Very related question. Is it good to have your own mentor within the project?
Well, I can tell you from my experience as a panel member that this has not been viewed favorably by the panel. It shows that there is a lack of independence sometimes, that you still depend on your supervisor for materials or for expertise, and that probably he has an input in the preparation of the proposal.
Yes.
So, in my experience, from the LS4 panel that I was, it would not be a good idea.
This is quite important tip for everyone, because we have mentioned very often problems like that, that the mentors included in the grant project were not beneficial, were rather reducing the chance to get the accepted grant than getting it. Another questions? Yes, please.
My name is Agnieszka Rabuszka from Poznań Medical University. I'm wondering about this high-risk balance. Like, how to find the point to convince reviewers to give me money to a risky project? Is my previous experience, amount of preliminary data? On the other hand, I believe like too much preliminary data, which like make, like, I don't know, already 40% of the grant is, like, then it's safe. And what is this high-risk balance?
I think that simply there is no real answer, because every grant is different, every stage of career is different, and that's why it's good to read previous proposals and ask your colleagues, because I agree that 40% of preliminary data is wrong, but maybe 15-20 will be fine. If you had an excellent previous publication, you don't need this preliminary data. It is case-specific situation, I'm afraid.
Very good idea is to be present on the mock panels, for example, in our excellence office, because such questions or such problems will be immediately found by the experts during the meeting.
The important thing is to be able to demonstrate that you can carry out what you are proposing. This is very important. If the project is risky, you need to put extra effort into convincing the reviewer that you can actually do what you are proposing to do. You need perhaps to provide contingency planning in case things don't go well, because you know risky projects have risky components. If something doesn't pan out the way you plan, what is going to happen? Is the project dead? If you can provide alternatives, if you can provide exit strategies, and eventually show that you are in a place where there is enough infrastructure, because this is also something that is taken care by the panels. Sometimes people propose to do things, but they don't have the infrastructure. The institution where they are simply doesn't have the proper instruments, that doesn't have the proper infrastructure. If you can convince that you are in a position to actually deliver, then you can go with as much risk as you like. But really convince that you can carry out research, not just fantasy.
And here I would like to emphasize these alternatives. Professor Dziembowski already talked about it. You need to show alternative because always you can get different results from expected. And if you are not able to show the alternative, the expert panel probably would also be against this project. It's an important issue.
Because at the first stage there is a panel, and they will, on one hand, does not very deeply read the proposal, but they will have this general rank who is the best in their minds. But then it's sent to the reviewers outside, which is completely distributed to the experts in the field. And they have these instructions. And these instructions say a lot of things. So you have to deeply think about this instruction, and then to secure yourself from using these instructions against you. So if they say, if they ask, I don't remember now exactly, that are there alternatives, what is the risk, you have to place it only in your full proposal to secure yourself against such things.
More questions? Yes, please.
My name is Piotr Skurka from Institute of Nature Conservation of Polish Academy of Sciences. I've got a question about interdisciplinary projects. I work in the field which is characterized by our study is at the edge of life sciences and, for example, human sciences. So how panel, expert panel, cope with the projects which are really at the edge of disciplines? How they manage to, for example, how to very decide to reject or classify projects as a, and it is appropriate or it is interdisciplinary and good?
So, as I said in the presentation, interdisciplinarity is encouraged, something that we encourage at the ERC. It may happen sometimes that the panel receives a grant that requires additional expertise that's not present in the panel. It might actually be present in a panel of a completely and entirely different domain. For example, life sciences combining humanities, or life sciences combining physical sciences and engineering. In those cases, these proposals are also sent to panel members of the domain where there is expertise relevant to the proposal to be evaluated. So, in those interdisciplinary proposals, you try to receive as many evaluations as possible coming from all areas of expertise that are related to the proposal, not just the expertise that's available in the particular panel that is your first option. You can also suggest alternative panels. So, for example, you may be applying in for panel LS4, but you may also indicate that your proposal can be evaluated by experts in physical sciences and engineering panel 3, depending on what technologies you might be using in your proposal or what other applications, if there are applications that are relevant to social sciences and humanities, for example. So you can sort of channel your proposal to the appropriate panel. If the panel realizes that there is not enough expertise, there is always the option to seek additional reviews from other panels of completely different domains or reviewers that are not within the domain of the panel.
And I will look for all grants which were granted in kind of fields you are, and possibly that will make give you a hint. For example, if it was more as a humanity or LS panels. If the more grants which are at the edge were given at the end, because at the end they claim which panel it was.
Yes.
So this main distinction you can look by, you know.
It was mentioned that reviewers have to answer some specific questions during the evaluation process. Is it possible to obtain this set of questions from the previous code of the ERC grants?
Specific questions
for reviewers they have to answer during evaluation. Data evaluation.
Evaluation criteria, I suppose they are
All those are priorities of the panels, and you can find on the information online. I showed you already some of the criteria that are employed. So the criteria of evaluation are available online. There's even a guide to referees and panel members that you can find online that specifically describes how a proposal should be evaluated. So if I'm functioning as a reviewer, I read those instructions to see what exactly I should do, how should I evaluate the proposal. Everything is online.
Okay, so software reviewers follow the same criteria as are available in the internet, right?
Yes.
Or they have another set of more specific questions to answer.
You mean the questions reviewers that are distributed internally or so? No, not that I'm aware of.
Hello, my name is Adam Hermit, I'm from Netsky Institute. I've got a question, is it possible to combine, for example, preclinical studies or basic studies on rats and human studies, clinical human studies?
In panel LS7, there are many proposals that fit exactly that category. So they combine preclinical studies, even clinical trials, minimal, of course, because the funding is not enough to perform a proper clinical trial in humans, but preclinical trials using models, humanized mice, rats, etc., and then going to a clinical setting are more than allowed. And actually, that's the focus of LS7.
Thank you. Short question, actually. I'm collaborating with people who are not scientists and developed therapy, physical therapy that appears to do miracles in neurological and psychiatric diseases like autism. And my question is whether such project evaluating and developing this therapy would be good for ERC grants. And under what circumstances should there be a synergy grant? And I said these people with I collaborate with are not scientists.
So we are talking about research funding. So there has to be a major research component in the proposal. It's not about describing some methodology and then listing what the effectiveness is, for example, by doing an epidemiological study or an analysis of the effectiveness of the technique. It has to be a research proposal. So research needs to be involved, and you need to have a way of addressing the basic fundamental biological mechanisms. Why this particular approach is effective? What is the cellular, the molecular basis of the effectiveness of a drug, for example, or a particular technique that might be applied? Otherwise, just describing the technique or the describing the drug, just naming the drug and then listing how it was effective in a population of people that we tested it is not sufficient.
Okay, thank you.
There is still one question pending from the beginning regarding the low success rate in Poland. Could you just in 1 minute summarize which are the most important factors in this problem? Am I right?
I was also interested about whether there is any kind of debate or policy applied to improve this situation from the standpoint of either the authorities of science in Poland or the probably the ministry.
I think we'll discuss about that also during the next session after the lunch.
The ERC has been deeply concerned about these issues, not just about Poland, but about the low success rate in EU13 and other countries, not just EU13. So the low success rate deeply concerns us. It's something very worrying that we want to address. So the ERC has tried and has actually studied this phenomenon in depth, trying to understand the real reasons, what is behind this lagging of the success rates. So we looked, for example, at GDP, how GDP in a country affects the success rate, how the funding that is allocated specifically to research affects success rate, how high impact publications or their lack thereof affects success rates. And I'm going to present this, specific data in the presentation afterwards, but let me just tell you for now, for Poland and for other countries, my country included, it's not national gross domestic product that determines success. Although there is correlation, I don't want to be mistaken here, to be misunderstood. There is correlation between success rate and GDP, but there are countries that are underperforming even. So Poland is one of those countries. So GDP is not a predictor of success for Poland. The expenditure on research and development is not a predictor for Poland. Also, the number of high-impact publications or publications in prestigious journals is not a predictor for Poland. So then what's wrong? What is the problem? The problem is that there is not a culture yet developed in a country, and this is where we see that there is a lot that can be done in Poland and in other countries. So the, Poland, as well as, for example, Greece and other EU-13 countries, they need to develop the tools at the national level that will allow them to become countries that are competitive. So, for example, what the Academy is doing here in Poland is great. This is a transformative action. Training the community, training the scientific community of a country so that they can be more effective. It's not a matter of how many high-impact applications Poland is churning out. This is not a predictor. There is a correlation. For most of the European countries, there is an almost perfect correlation between the impact of the publications that's coming out of the country and the number of grants, the success rate of that country. But there are underperforming countries. Poland is one of them. I was going to show specific details and data later on, so I could show it now, but I think we'll be late.
And I think we can see also in Poland there are particular places where there is possibly a different culture, like, I don't know, mathematics, informatics faculty on the University of Warsaw, 7 ERC grants. That's something what how it should be in other places. Yes? And it's not an institution we have 5,000 people. It's the normal faculty, I don't know, 300 people working there. So that means that this is something not economical exactly, but, you know, this is a place where more people ask more interesting questions and train young people different. We also know that this is one of the faculties, especially informatics, more difficult to get there. Yeah. So also the students are probably special.
What we found out through these studies that ERC has conducted is that there is tremendous potential in EU-13 countries and in Poland in particular. What needs to happen is a turn towards excellence, towards the mentality of excellence, not just a situation where mediocre is enough, but instead focusing on excellence, focusing on internationalization, becoming more open, so developing an environment that is attractive for people, Polish people abroad, who are particularly successful, actually. And this is one trend that we see for many countries, Greece included. Nationals of Greece, of Poland, are very successful, are more successful than the people that are actually residing in the countries in terms of competitiveness for ERC funding. So the environment needs to be there that will attract these people to come back. This is one thing. But also other people, not necessarily Polish nationals, but would enrich the scientific ecosystem of Poland. And they are made towards direction of excellence. National schemes are, of course, very important if they are also focusing on excellence, not just in distributing funding evenly throughout so that everybody's happy and you know, nobody complains. There also needs to be a national effort towards maintaining, establishing and maintaining excellence. And this will, in the long run, in a few years, I think, will result in a higher success rate. Poland is a big country, a great country with tradition, long tradition in sciences, and I think that it can be done. Similarly to other underperforming countries, so EU 13 countries, my country included as well.
And I will stop at this point, this very interesting discussion. I would like to thank to everybody, the audience, to Professor Tavernarakis, to Professor Jembowski.